Hi, my name is Ranger Yeva, and I'm standing out here in the sawgrass prairie of Everglades National Park. This place is also called the River of Grass because it can be completely flooded for about half of the year. Here in South Florida, we have two seasons, the wet season in the summer and the dry season in the winter. But no matter the season, all of the plants and animals in the Everglades ecosystem need that water to survive.
Oh, well, gee whiz! This place sure has changed since I was little. Oh, I remember zipping around with my grandpappy through the sawgrass prairie. Oh, we would walk for weeks through the marshes, camping on the hammock islands and poling through the mangroves. My pappy, he knew this place like the back of his hand. He would even take surveyors and scientists out into the backcountry. Us Glazemen, we understood the seasons, the water levels, and the wildlife. Now there's still some water here, but not like the old days.
You're right, Mr. Glazeman. The water in the Everglades has been impacted by people as well. Settlers came here about 100 years ago and changed the water flow. Historically, the water in the Kissimmee River Basin up by Orlando would flow into Lake Okeechobee, which is shaped like a big shallow bowl. In the wet season, Lake Okeechobee would overflow, slowly flowing down in a wide, shallow river all the way down to Florida Bay. If the water flowing through the sawgrass prairie doesn't evaporate or make it all the way down to Florida Bay, it seeps into the ground. Water percolates through the limestone bedrock and into the Biscayne Aquifer. Think of this aquifer like a big underground lake trapped in layers of limestone deep underneath our feet. As people came down to settle in South Florida, they decided they couldn't build, farm, or drive on flooded land. So they built canals, dikes, and borrow pits, diverting the water away from the Everglades and out to the Atlantic Ocean and the Gulf of Mexico, dramatically changing the amount of water that's able to flow through this park. The water here in South Florida is actually very important. Not just for the animals and the plants, but also for us people. We use the water in many different ways. I actually have a friend who's visiting the park right now. Let's call them to find out how they use the water.
Oh, hello there, Ranger Yeva. My name is Jerry Snowbird. I escaped the cold, white, snowy north up there, and I am so excited to be down here in southern Florida. It's been so nice and warm lately. I've been soaking up all the breeze out at the beach. I've been touring the water parks and the theme parks and hanging out in all the jacuzzis and the pools, and now I finally get to experience what the Everglades has to offer.
That all sounds like a blast. So my friend here wants to know what the water and the Everglades means to you.
Holy wow, water is the most important part of the Everglades to me. It's so important because it's so hot down here and I spend a lot of time out in the sun. I gotta cool off somehow. Oh, I also wouldn't be able to do any of the fun recreation that I like doing down here, like maybe canoeing or a little bit of kayaking or maybe an airboat tour. Oh man, the habitats down here in South Florida are so much better to be seen from the water. And it's also amazing how much fun you can have while doing it. But I actually gotta go. I have signed up for a ranger guided sluice logging tour, so I will talk to you later.
Well, thanks, Jerry. Have fun on your tour and be careful.
Bye, Jerry.
Let's call another friend who uses the water in a different way.
Oh, hi, Ranger Yeva. It's Edith, and I am actually just outside of Everglades National Park working on a project. Well, engineers like myself built things like grocery stores, gas stations, houses, roads, hotels, you name it, we build it. I absolutely love the Everglades and working in South Florida. In the past, we drained areas of the Everglades to build schools, hospitals, and apartments, but this was horrible for the plants and the animals that call the Everglades their home. Nowadays, we build infrastructures like the pump station behind me as part of our comprehensive Everglades Restoration Plan, or SERP for short, to bring back some of that natural flow of water into the Everglades. Plants, humans, and animals can live better together. I have to get back to work, but I'll see you around.
Thanks, Builder Edith. That's really great. Have fun. See ya.
Bye, Edith.
Back to work.
All right, Mr. Gladesman, we've talked to a couple friends, but there's one other friend we need to call who also uses the water here in South Florida. Let's try her.
Hello, this is Savannah Wilder from Terra Farms. How can I help you?
Hi, Savannah. It's Ranger Yeva and my friend here, Mr. Gladesman. How do you use the water here in South Florida?
Well, water plays a big role in my life. I love living and working here in South Florida. It rarely freezes here, and it's a great place to grow things like juicy tomatoes and sweet, sweet strawberries. Right now, I actually have broccoli and some other collard greens growing, and they definitely need water just like I do. A lot of the Everglades was destroyed to make room for farmland, so I try to do my part to protect the water and grow sustainably by using less fertilizer and planting some native plants for the animals that were here first. Without the clean and fresh water of the Everglades, my farm and I wouldn't stand a chance. Oh dang, the crows are after my crops again. I gotta run.
Uh-oh, I hope the crows don't get all her food.
I hope not.
So we've been pretty lucky to talk to our friends, the tourist, the developer, and the farmer today. And they all use water here in South Florida in different ways that are all very important.
Yeah.
I am Ernest, the wood stork. And I speak for all the animals of the Everglades. I couldn't help but overhear your conversation. In the Everglades, the water that was here is just a fraction of what it used to be. My grandparents told me of the days that the sun would be blocked out from all the birds in the sky, but that is no more. They also spoke of days where water covered the land for months. You would think it would go on forever. Now, due to all these changes, there are barely enough resources to go around. The fertilizers from the farm and the cities with their runoff find their way into the Everglades, and that's no good for any of us. Some humans think that they are separate from us here, but in reality, we are all connected.
You're right, Ernest. All of these water users are important, but so are all of the animals and plants that call the Everglades their home. We can't just tell people to move or flood their houses, but everybody can make a difference. Mr. Gladesman, what do you think are some things that people could do at home to help conserve some water for the Everglades?
Oh, dang. Well, I think I could certainly take quicker showers. Maybe turn off the faucet when I'm not using it, and using a reusable water bottle like my grandkids. You see, I want to make sure this place is around for even my great, 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 great grandchildren. I've always loved coming up here and sharing this place with others, and I want them to be able to do the same.
I couldn't agree more. There is only one Everglades, and it's up to all of us to protect this special place. The Everglades replenishes the drinking water of South Florida and is a home for many plant and animal species, some of which can't be found anywhere else in the entire world. We all need water, but it's important we take only what we need.
Just like my grandpappy used to say, save some for the fishes